What is self-location?
So self-location refers to scenarios in which you are uncertain about your location within the universe. You might be uncertain where you are or when you are, or if you're in a multiverse, you might be uncertain about which universe within the multiverse you are currently located in. So it's those kinds of questions pertaining to a location within a universe.
And there's something between pure and superficial, if I'm not mistaken. What are those?
Yeah, so when we talk about self-locating uncertainty in philosophy or in physics, I think there are two important, importantly different classes of self-locating uncertainty that we should distinguish between. What I call pure self-locating uncertainty refers to cases where you are uncertain about what location you are out of a possible class of locations which are all located within the same world. Adam Elgar's case falls into that bracket. That's a case in which Dr. Evil, or a person who believes himself to be Dr. Evil, receives a credible message telling him that a subjectively identical duplicate has been made of Dr. Evil and placed somewhere. So in that case, he's now uncertain whether he is, in fact, the real Dr. Evil or the duplicate. But both of those people exist within one and the same world. So that is pure self-locating uncertainty. By contrast, superficially self-locating uncertainty refers to the case where you're uncertain about your location, but the possible locations you could be in belong to different possible worlds. So, for example, suppose you wake up and you haven't looked at the clock yet, so you don't know what time it is. You're uncertain about your location in time. Uh-huh. But of course, in every possible world, there's exactly one time at which you actually wake up. And so the different possible times you could be located in belong to different possible worlds corresponding to those different possible times you could wake up. So that's, I think, an importantly different type of self-location.
Is this related to the Sleeping Beauty paradox?
Yes. So the Sleeping Beauty paradox, in fact, involves a mixture of pure and superficially self-locating uncertainty. So I think the correct way to analyze that is to appeal to your scientific theory to determine the superficially self-locating credences, and then to assign the pure credences any way you want. So the outcome is that the correct solution is the double Hafer solution.
Okay. Well, it'd be useful for you to outline what the paradox is at this point, and then why you think the solution is the double half one.
Okay, yeah. So the Sleeping Beauty paradox refers to a scenario in which an experiment is being performed on you. You're going to be put to sleep, and then you'll be woken up either once or twice in the course of the experiment. We'll just decide which one it is based on the outcome of a coin flip. So we flip the coin, and if it lands heads, then you'll be woken once on Monday, and if it lands on tails, then you'll be woken twice on Monday and Tuesday. So the question is about what credences should you assign to the outcome of the coin toss? Should you assign and do the credences change if you're woken up and then told what day it is? So various different approaches have been taken to try to decide what the correct assignation of probabilities is. Most philosophers, I think, are of the view that when you learn something about what day it is, you ought to change your credences. My view is that because the coin flip is the coin flip issue is a superficially self-locating issue, whereas the issues about when you are located are pure. The outcome is that the further information shouldn't actually change any of your assignations of credences, because the right way to assign credences in these situations is always to assign the superficial self-location credences first, and then, having done that, arrange your self-locating, your pure credences as you would like. That means that the pure information isn't going to change the superficial information, and so the probability is always going to be half, regardless of waking up.
Now, was there something about when they say you get woken up twice, that after you get woken up once, you take something to forget that you woke up once?
Yes, you are not going to know that you've woken up at once or twice.
Now, what does any of this have to do with physical law?
Yeah. So self-location is important to physical law, particularly in the context of physical theories that deal with multiverses. So in particular, the cosmological multiverse and the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics has a multiverse. And in both of these multiverses, in order to make certain kinds of predictions, it's necessary that you assign some credences over locations within the multiverse. You have to assign probabilities to which universe you might be within this multiverse. And so all of those approaches to making predictions in a multiverse are kind of predicated on the assumption that there is, in fact, some objectively right or uniquely correct way to assign your self-locating credences over parts of the multiverse. And so therefore they are necessarily predicated on the claim that there are unique ways to assign pure self-locating credences. There's a right way to do it and there's a wrong way to do it. So I think that's wrong. I think that for superficially self-locating credences, there are right ways to assign them because those credences can just be inherited from a scientific theory. But in the pure case, there is nothing whatsoever which could compel you or constrain you to assign your credences in any particular way. So any assignation of credences is fine. And therefore, you're not going to be able to get meaningful predictions out of any theory which involves this kind of multiverse reasoning. So if I'm right about that, that's a serious problem, both for the cosmological multiverse and for the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics, because it seems to say that we can't make meaningful predictions in that context, and we therefore can't obtain any sensible evidence for scientific theories in that context, because there's nothing to sort of predict and then see if it comes true.
I'm sure you've spoken to Sean Carroll about this. So have you, and what has he said, or what do you think he would say?
I have not spoken to Sean Carroll about this. I know that Carroll has a view of the multiverse, and of the Everettian multiverse in particular, which is based on the idea that, you know, certain constraints on self-locating credences, can help tell you how to assign probabilities in the Everettian case. I do think this view says that approach is wrong. There are no rational constraints on self-locating credences in the Everettian scenario. And so any model which sort of takes that as its starting point, I think, cannot be right.
I believe in 1907, if I'm not mistaken, Einstein had his happiest thought about free fall and weightlessness.
Yeah.
Have you had a happiest thought?
Had a happiest thought? I think one moment I'd pick out is there's a theorem in quantum foundations called the PBR theorem. The PBR theorem is about the reality of the quantum state. It attempts to prove that if in order to reproduce all of the predictions of quantum mechanics, it must be the case that the quantum state is a real objective thing which travels through time, conveying information from one time to another. And I think thinking about this theorem, one thing that struck me was that the whole theorem was predicated on the assumption of, you know, what I would call temporal locality. It's predicated on the assumption that, you know, if a measurement result depends on earlier preparation, there must be something which travels between them carrying that information from one point to another. So that, I think, was the origin of most of my work on temporal non-locality, was the observation that there's this significant assumption being made in this theorem that is perhaps not being questioned in the way that it should be.
Do you have any thoughts about eternalism versus presentism? And can you please briefly define those terms?
Yeah. So presentism is a philosophical view which says that, you know, in some sense, only the present is real. The past and the future are not currently real. Eternalism says that, you know, the whole of history is real at once. There's no sort of privileged present moment. It's all there. I am, as you might expect, given my views on all at once physics, I'm definitely more on the eternalist side. I think it's very hard to make presentism work in a way that is compatible with relativity, because, you know, relativity denies that there exists a global present. So it's kind of unclear what the present even is in that picture. And people have, you know, made attempts to sort of reformulate presentism in relativistic ways. But, you know, I think all of them feel a bit ad hoc and not very compelling to me. So certainly in the context of what we know about physics now, eternalism seems to me much more viable.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.